What is your name?
My name is Seth Shostak.
And are you an expert in looking for aliens?
Well, put it this way, I have devoted some of my career to the question of whether we're alone and whether we could find somebody else.
Okay, so are we alone?
Well, we don't know whether we're alone or not. It would surprise me if we were, and I certainly would get another job if I really thought that that was a likely outcome of the kind of work we're doing. But honestly, if you ask me, is there anybody out there, I can hardly believe they're not out there.
So you think there are other human-like intelligent aliens in the universe?
Well, I don't know that they're human-like. I mean, it depends on what you consider human-like. You know, do they like poetry? Do they go to the movies on the weekend? They might not be that human-like, but that they're intelligent enough to figure out the laws of nature, you know, maybe to communicate with not only one another, but with others. And those are the kind of aliens we look for.
Well, since you've dedicated some large fraction of your life to looking for aliens, why are you so convinced that these intelligent aliens exist?
You know,
a lot of people aren't as convinced as you are. You seem to be more convinced than most.
Well, actually, I think I'm not more convinced than most. Certainly, surveys that have been done on this in the United States, and generally what you find in the United States also applies to places like Australia, New Zealand, Japan, Europe, is that most people believe the aliens are out there. I think they probably do that because they see them every night on television, or they see them on the weekend on the movies, but I think that they're out there simply on the basis of the numbers. It's not more sophisticated than that.
Basis of numbers. So there are a lot of stars, a lot of planets.
Exactly.
But wait, there's another thing called invention, the evolution of life, and the evolution of intelligence. So you must think that those are fairly high.
Well, I don't think that the evolution of life is such a difficult problem, probably because I don't know very much about it. Then again, you could argue that maybe none of us knows too much about it. But life got started very early on Earth. That's somewhat suggestive. It isn't so hard to make intelligent life. To make life. But intelligent life, yes, you're right. It may be that you got lots and lots of planets with life, but none of it gets very clever. You know, nature may not put a premium on getting clever, and I prove that to myself every day when I talk to my neighbors.
But you don't prove it to yourself to such an extent that you would change your job.
No. And I don't say that simply because the job pays a lot of money, because it doesn't. I do it because it's interesting. And because, you know, there have been 10,000 generations of humans before us. They probably all wondered what was up in the sky. And this is the first generation where at least there's some chance that we could find that, you know, there's life out there.
So even though you're not that convinced that there's intelligent life out there, you're willing to do it because it's an incredible adventure for you?
Well, an adventure. I mean, it's like solving puzzles. It's not an adventure in the sense that mapping the Himalayas would be an adventure, right? I mostly sit at a desk and wrestle with email. But it is true that the technology to do a search for intelligent life, not to mention the fact that we're learning more about the cosmos all the time and the nature of planets and what planets are out there and that sort of thing. I mean, none of this was known when I was a kid. And so, you know, the situation really has changed. I suppose you could liken it to the situation in Europe at the end of the 14th century, right? When suddenly they had ships that could conceivably cross the oceans and maybe find something new.
Right. So I'm much more skeptical about intelligent life elsewhere, but I'm in favor of SETI because you're looking at parameter space that hasn't been looked at before. I guess that's also part of your motivation.
There is that, and that's the history of astronomy. Every time you build an instrument that has new capabilities, if you will, so it's opening up parameter space, you almost always find something. Almost always. I would say always, but in the case of SETI, it hasn't been true yet. So, I don't know. Maybe that's not a motivation.
In the question, are we alone, who's the we?
Well, the we is Homo sapiens. Because I mean, you could say, you know, from the standpoint of the hippos, you know, they probably wonder if they're alone. Or maybe they don't. But, and the trilobites could have wondered it, and then T-Rex might have wondered it too. But, you know, they weren't sort of self-aware enough perhaps to do that. But when I say, are we alone, yeah, I mean other intelligent beings that appreciate, you know, reality, television, and good poetry.
So you don't mean just we, the telescope owners of the developed world, you mean we, the entire species?
Yes, this is for humanity. I mean,
okay, how about Neanderthals? If they were around, would they be part of your we?
No, our definition of intelligent, I mean, I a great sympathy for Neanderthals, many of my friends, but
you're about 2.5% Neanderthal.
Yes, so I'm told. I use that to explain my bad behavior on occasion. But now our definition of intelligence is strictly operational. If you can build a radio transmitter or a big laser or something like that, we call you intelligent. I mean,
so
obviously,
that means operational. That applying that definition to Earth means that only the developed countries with radio telescopes are intelligent countries.
Yeah, well, yes, radio transmitters. No, yes, those are the intelligent ones. I hope I don't let that come out in my cocktail party conversation.
Now, so we as Homo sapiens, but I ask you that because half the population think that, or particularly biologists, think that we is the life on Earth.
Yeah, but they may. Yes. I would subscribe to that. Really, I don't have so much bias against, you know, the caterpillars in my backyard. The only thing is they're not going to make a search for life elsewhere, and they're not going to make themselves known to life elsewhere as a species particularly, but maybe as biology, that could be. But, we could argue about these definitions, but it's really very simple. We're just looking for something that's putting some information out into the cosmos, a radio wave, a flashing lights, a big construction, something that indicates that, you know, they've gone beyond mere subsistence.
So are you a member of the group of non-biologists who believe that if we detect life on Mars, that we will still be alone?
Well, Mars is a little bit complicated, but because of course it could be that Mars life is related to Earth life. In that case, you can argue, well, I mean, if we're the Martians or the Martians...
Let's say we detect microbial life somewhere. Will we still be alone, according to you?
Yeah. Yes. Yes. There'll be pond scum elsewhere. And that's interesting. I try and get it out of my bathtub. But if you're talking about intelligence, yes, I think that would mean that we're still alone.
But some people think you need to be able to communicate with something in order not to be alone. So you share that.
I don't know about communication. Communication implies an exchange of information back and forth. And given the distances in the universe, you know, maybe that isn't going to happen. But if you can find that there is something, or was, more likely was than is, something out there that reached at least our level of technology and really a little bit beyond it, then I would say, okay, we're not the only game in town.
Is "are we alone" an important question?
I think it's a very important question. I mean, philosophically, it's not that you're going to really get maybe anything useful out of it, right? It would be like, I don't know, suppose you went back to 1400 and you told the Incas, right, in South America, you know, on the other side of all that water, there are other societies, other cities, other people worrying about the same things you're worried about.
But wait, you said we're not going to get anything useful. Do you think we've not gotten anything useful out of, like, for example, Darwinism, understanding that we evolved from monkeys and apes?
Well, getting something useful, I meant in a practical sense. All right, philosophically, it's very important. Darwin was important philosophically.
So you think Darwinism is practical?
There are practical aspects of Darwinism. If you're doing, you know, cancer research or something, you're probably dependent on Darwin evolution to help you. But in terms of, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Front Porch, right, is it going to be important to them? Yes, I think philosophically, to know that, okay, you know, we're unique, but we're not special, that kind of thing.
I would have thought that knowing who you are and your place in the universe provides it's the fundamental of making progress in the universe and science in general.
I'm not sure of that, but maybe. Okay. I think it would help, at least it won't hurt, put it that way.
All right, so the scientific understanding of how you got here, is that important?
Yes, of course it is. I mean, it's like, well, is
but
it...
But not to everybody, but to you...
Not to everybody, but I mean, is quantum mechanics important? I mean, you could ask that. And, you know, when they first came up with quantum mechanics 100 years ago, even the people who were doing that didn't think it was important in a practical sense. They just wanted to know how the universe worked. They wanted to know how these small particles worked. It turns out that it has lots and lots of applications. I don't know if finding evidence for aliens is going to have practical applications. Maybe not. But at least you know something that you always wondered about, and now you know the answer, and you'll know it forever.
Do you think that life in general is getting more complex? Do you think that's a general feature of evolution, no matter where it would be in the universe, or do you think it's a feature of life on Earth?
I don't think it's a feature of life on Earth. I mean, it's Darwinian evolution. I mean, it's just a matter of keep trying things, and this worked in this environment, so we'll keep it around. I mean, it's really very simple if you're talking about evolution of life, right? But that means that because it is only expanding largely expanding, or maybe not even largely, but certainly expanding into new environments all the time, then you can say, well, it's a better design machine for that environment. In that sense, it's more complex.
So is life getting more complex?
I think it is. I'm not a biologist, as far as I can tell. My personal life is getting more complex.
Okay.
How's that?
If I give you $100 billion with the caveat you had to spend it to try to answer the question, are we alone, how would you spend it?
$100 billion is a fair amount of money. Mm-hmm. I certainly would up the quality of the dinners I eat. But I think the other thing that you would do is you'd put an array of antennas, perhaps on the far side of the moon,
This is a SETI search. Now.
That's a SETI search. I think the reason we haven't found any signals is not because there aren't any signals out there. I think, you know, using radio to communicate, no matter what kind of civilization you are. That makes a lot of sense. It's like using the wheel. I presume that the aliens will have the wheel, even though it's a pretty old invention. So if they're using radio for anything, if you can have a very, very sensitive instrument that isn't compromised by all the noise on Earth, then I would do that.
So what fraction of this $100 billion would you spend on SETI searches versus, for example, I don't know, planetary probes or going to Alpha Centauri to try to find life on another Earth-like planet?
You know, on television, the preferred option for finding the aliens is to dress up a bunch of people in kind of a spandex uniforms and send them to go boldly go look for the aliens.
Now, that in the middle of the night in some lonely path.
I mean, I don't think that that's the way to do it any more than I think the best way to do it is just sit around and wait for them to land. There are people who prefer that approach.
Right, but what fraction of this $100 billion would you spend on SETI versus other methods? For example, would you invest in microscopes to try to find nano-aliens in this room?
Yeah, well, there are people who are very keen on the idea that there might be a second genesis of life here on Earth. I mean, that's an interesting question. But if you're talking about finding intelligent life, you're not going to find it with a microscope. In my opinion, you're not going to find that.
If you find a nano spaceship, that's obvious evidence of intelligence somewhere.
Yes, I would be astounded.
But you wouldn't invest.
I wouldn't put my money there. If you find a nano spaceship, do send me an email about it, and I'll buy you a dinner.
Okay, but what fraction would you? What fraction would go into SETI?
I think most of it would go into
90%.
SETI. 90%? Well, 100%. I mean, it sounds very self-serving.
Yes, it does. But no one else has had that high a percentage of when I've asked this question.
Well, they probably work in a different field.
All right. Now, some people have said we shouldn't be looking for alien life on planets. We shouldn't be looking for organic life because after organic life comes these technological life. You float around between stars and you're not associated with the surface of a wet planet. So what's your view on that?
Well, I happen to think that that's not a bad idea, actually, because it seems that the trajectory, at least for us, is fairly clear that we're going to invent synthetic intelligence.
So why are you looking at stars in the SETI program? Why don't you look in just voids?
Well, part of the problem is that if you just say, I'm going to look everywhere, that greatly complicates the experiment, right? So, Columbus didn't sail in any direction. He sailed to the west, and there were reasons that he had for doing that. He had a destination in mind. Okay, in our case, you know, we continue to look in the direction of stars that are thought to have maybe suitable planetary systems. But I honestly think that a lot of that is just history. That's what SETI has always done. So there's this tremendous, there's this momentum, this giant machine moving in that direction. Well, giant. And so I think a lot of it is that. The other thing is, if you say, well, they could be anywhere, it's hard to fashion your experiment.
You have very narrow regions of frequency space where you're looking. Okay, do you think if life evolved, I mean, if we went in a time machine, go back, let's say, before the Cambrian, and then let life evolve again, do you think anything like humans or human-like intelligence would evolve again?
That's a big question for which I am incapable of providing an adequate answer. Nobody seems to know. You could say, well, what if the rock that slammed into the Yucatan 66 million years ago had arrived an hour earlier, would have missed the Earth? You and I wouldn't be having this conversation. There would be dinosaurs in New Zealand, right? So, and the question is, well, okay, maybe, but would the dinosaurs simply have eventually evolved the kind of intelligence we have, and there would still be, you know, technological societies here on Earth? And I don't know the answer to that, and apparently nobody knows the answer to that, do
you? You know the dinosaurs evolved for, 150 million years and didn't get giant brains like we see.
That's right.
So
in fact, I asked...
That's evidence against this idea.
Well, it does, in a way. Well, maybe what they needed was 200 million years. But it's true that an evolutionary biologist said, look, Seth, you know, the dinos did have 150 million years to get smart and didn't. So what would another 100 million years have done for them? And maybe they all would have turned into chickens, and that's good for me.
So since you're not a biologist, you're pretty agnostic about how likely the origin of life or the origin of multicellular life or the origin of intelligence is, and you don't care that much because that's not your specialty. But because there's some doubt about it, you think there's enough doubt to make it worthwhile to search.
I think exactly that.
Okay.
That, this is an experiment. It's really exploration. It's like sitting around in Europe for, you know, a couple of hundred years asking, you think there's a continent at the bottom of the globe, right? And, you know, you can't solve that particular puzzle. You can't answer that question by sitting around drinking a lot of beer and discussing it. And eventually you have to do an experiment and send some ships down there. So I think it's the same thing with SETI.
What kind of aliens would you like to find? Close your eyes, take a deep breath. Emotional Seth. What kind would you like to find?
Emotional Seth. He's down there somewhere.
Yes, I know. I'm looking for him.
Yeah, good luck. He might look for the aliens. I don't actually care very much except insofar as...
I'm not talking to you rational. Come on, you give me an irrational answer.
Yeah,
Close
yeah.
your eyes. deep breath, close your eyes, deep breath. What kind of aliens would you like to find?
I would like to find an alien that could say something that was more interesting than what I normally hear. And so I guess that's it.
More interesting.
I listen, I don't...
That's low threshold, not to answer all our unanswered questions.
No, come on.
Why don't you just watch a better TV channel?
Yeah, right. Well, you said, all the aliens in the movies tend to be, you know, little gray guys with not much in the way of personality,
so you
actually.
You just want something a little bit more interesting than your fellow human beings.
Yeah, I mean, nothing against my friends or neighbors, but, you know, actually, if you're going to find something new, it would be interesting if it really were new and not just, you know, your cousin, you know, with different hairstyle.
You have a favorite alien movie?
I do. Oh, do I? Well, I think so. I mean, I'm an aficionado of cheesy sci-fi films. And I think as a kid, I was very much influenced by War of the Worlds.
Oh.
But it didn't say too much about aliens, except that they were mostly hostile.
Yes.
But I liked the Alien, the first of the Alien series. I thought that that was very good. And there have been some recently that have also explored sort of another aspect of aliens. They're not just here to flatten Los Angeles. Mm. Although as a resident of Northern California, honestly, I have no problem with that.
Now, there's a little bit of a debate about whether we should be listening or whether we should be sending signals. I think Stephen Hawking said, hey, we should keep our head down. I think Jerry Ostreicher, when I interviewed him, he said we shouldn't even listen because if we listen, we're going to be convinced to kill ourselves. You know, this is like memes that take over your brain and make you kill yourself, and so then the aliens come and take over the planet. So there's a whole range of ideas about how active we should be here. What is your opinion on that?
Well, I think that Jerry Ostreicher actually is... got a kind of he should have more fun in life if that's what he really thinks.
Surprised. You think we should listen? How about sending some signals?
Yeah, well, you know, there are people. I have no problem with sending things either. Mm-hmm. I think from a practical point of view, right, the nearest life, intelligent life, might be hundreds of light years away, maybe 1,000 light, but let's say hundreds. All right, so you send a message and it takes hundreds of years to get there. And if anybody's at the receiving end, that's another couple of hundred years before they get back to you. You know, your funding will evaporate before any of that happens.
But you know the statistics, the likelihood that you'll find something 1 or 2 billion years more advanced are higher than finding one at approximate atomic energy level kind of thing.
Yes, no, yes, so, no, absolutely.
So if that's the case, why aren't you afraid of that?
I'm not, well.
Because you killed amoebas on a daily basis.
Well, I try not to, but yes, you're right. On the other hand, if you're really worried that, okay, we hear something, now, there are two dangers you've cited here. One is that we're so discouraged by the fact that these guys are so much more advanced than we are that we say, okay, that's it. We're just going to kill ourselves. I've never noticed that kind of behavior here on Earth.
It's called drinking of ethnic minorities. I mean, when your culture gets rolled over, then you lose confidence in yourself, and then when you do
that.
Yeah,
but they're still here. I mean, okay.
Well, no.
Some are. Maybe not in Tasmania. I don't know. But I don't foresee that because you won't know enough to make that decision. All you know is that there's some signal coming your way. And you can say, well, they're obviously more advanced than we are. Otherwise, they couldn't make this signal. But it doesn't mean they're necessarily so far advanced that we should lose confidence in ourselves. I don't notice the ants in the backyard where I live, you know, giving it all up and saying, that's it for ants because there's this big thing that walks into the yard every now and again. So that doesn't worry me. But as far as the deeper question, should we, in fact, make our presence known to the cosmos, mm-hmm. or could that just be dangerous? Mm-hmm. You know, we're making our presence known all the time, 24 hours a day. The radars down at the local airport beam the presence of airports into the cosmos. So I think it's, you know, that horse has left the barn.
Now, you've seen the movie Contact.
I have seen the movie. I was an advisor for the movie.
How many times have you seen that movie?
Well, I was sort of compelled to watch it more than once, actually, but not, you know, 3 or 4 times.
Three times during that movie, someone asks, are we alone? And the clever answer is, well, if we are alone, it would be an awful waste of space.
Right.
What do you think of that?
I think that that's a real estate developer view of the cosmos. You build all these galaxies, and it's true, if somebody somehow managed to eliminate all those galaxies tomorrow, that would affect us directly. That's just, you know, physics, the cosmos.
A real estate developer would not like to have other buildings everywhere. He would like to have empty buildings.
Well, you'd like to have his. Well,
I'd like to have space where you could build, and so it wouldn't be an awful waste of space. It would be great for a real estate developer. It's like an opposite of a real estate developer.
I'm not sure because their attitude is simply that if a place is not developed, right? Maybe you'd agree with this. If it's not developed, then you know somebody hasn't done their job, and it is kind of a waste of space. But you know, that was an argument that was used 1,000 years ago to. And posit that, you know, Jupiter and Saturn and
200 years here in Australia with Terra Nullius.
Well, okay. Okay. So
it seems like it seems like a racist remark. Says, hey, there are no human beings, and therefore it's a waste of space. Any place in the universe where there are no human beings, that's a waste. That seems like speciesism.
Oh,
finest, most barbed comment about speciesism I've ever heard.
Yeah, well, that could be. But I don't consider it a waste of space if there are not humans there. But if there's nobody there, if all that that's there is physics.
Pond scum?
Pond scum may be a slightly less wasteful use of space. But I don't think we ought to look at the cosmos that way. I mean, you know, if they're not there simply because otherwise it wouldn't make sense in this, you know, in this fashion. I'd find that an interesting argument, but not a very interesting argument.
Sometimes I've been tempted to accuse SETI researchers of looking for God, looking for some omniscient intelligence that's going to answer all their questions. How guilty are SETI researchers of that?
Well, they're not particularly religious, so in that sense, they would probably disagree with your premise. But on the other hand, maybe there's something to your premise in terms of trying to understand, you know, make sense of the cosmos, that there must be some sort of, if not order, at least some sort of logic to the universe. And their logic is, you know, whatever we've done, somebody else has done, or whatever's happening here on Earth has probably happened in many other places, because that gives
them
a nice
framework. They'll be more advanced, and they'll answer all our questions, kind of like a god does.
Well, I don't know, but I don't think anybody in the SETI biz counts on ever understanding messages from deep space. I mean, I've never heard anybody say that. Maybe they do deep in their hearts. They say, man, if we can only get in touch with the Klingons, they're going to tell us all sorts of really nifty stuff. I actually never do that in the movies for some reason, but... I don't know
any. The Klingons are more like the Neanderthals. We're looking for these more omniscient, godlike things that talk to us.
Yeah, the guys sort of the hollow cheek, gray-haired
much
guys.
More intelligent.
Yes.
Do you have a favorite solution to Fermi's paradox?
Fermi's paradox. Yeah, this idea that the aliens should be everywhere, we should see them everywhere. I mean, you know, to begin with, it's a very, very big conclusion based on a very local observation, as I am all too fond of saying. I looked out the window, you know, this morning. I didn't see any bears in my backyard. There's been plenty of time for bears to get into my backyard, and yet they're not there. So am I justified in concluding there are no bears in North America? Of course not. So I think that that's fundamentally what's wrong with
you
the Fermi paradox.
You also got up this morning and didn't see any bacteria, and so you could conclude there's no bacteria because you didn't have a microscope to look.
Right. That's perfectly legit. Yeah, so I don't think that proves anything. The fact that you don't see anything might just be a problem that you don't have the microscope. You don't have the right microscope.
What are the public's or students' biggest misconceptions about this question, are we alone?
I don't know what the biggest one is, but they have been largely shaped by the popular media. So their whole view of this is shaped by the popular media. And I can't tell you how many people either believe they are here. That's one third of the population right there. So, you know, you can take them out of the discussion because none of this is relevant. They know the aliens not only exist, but they're here visiting Earth, probably to improve their social life by abducting them for those breeding experiments. But I think that the other thing that they assume is too much anthropocentrism in terms of their motivations, their behavior, and so forth. A lot of people say, well, the reason you guys haven't heard anything is because the aliens are kind of fed up with us. They think we're too primitive because we have wars, we're changing the climate, we've got reality television. Whatever our sins are, they're adequate enough, they're sufficient to keep the aliens from getting in touch, which I think is a rather too self-focused point of view.
Okay, and do you have any advice for students who are thinking about becoming astrobiologists?
Yeah, I think astrobiology is obviously a growing field, right? I mean, 20, 30 years ago, there were no astrobiologists. I mean, there were people who were doing things that today would be called astrobiology, but it wasn't a field that you could get a degree in at many universities as it is now. And I think it's very interesting. It's only going to get more interesting because we're going to go to more and more places in our own solar system for sure. I don't know if we'll be going to the stars, but we have big telescopes, and with those, you can go to the stars. So if you're interested in this topic, I'd recommend it.
And are we alone?
Are we alone? You know, Charlie, if we're alone...
an awful way to spend.
Yeah, I don't know what my tombstone is going to read.
Okay.